Would you let him have control this morning? If you've given him control, would you just go ahead and thank him for taking control? He can handle it. Maybe there's some unconfessed sin. I was asked the effects of carnality on people and if a person could be carnal and be a Christian. Carnality will kill you. It will devastate you. And yes, you can be a Christian. But it'd be like hardening of the arteries in a physical body. It's hardening of the arteries in that spiritual body. God can change all that. He can soften it this morning. Will you let him? Father, in the name of Jesus this morning, we know you care. We know you love us. God, I pray for those in the midst of the storm this morning. The sails are torn. The wind's blowing mildly and the ship's being tossed to and fro. The waves are beating against the sides. Father, I pray that they call out to you this morning. That we'd allow you to speak the calmness of the voice of God. The one who controls the seas and the winds and all of that, God, that you want to control our life. And Father, that we would just maybe do the most difficult thing in our life as we discuss in our group this morning, and that's let you have control. And God, you'll come all of that in our life. So God, I pray this morning, God, in the midst of this time, in the midst of this worship service this morning, God, I pray, first of all, for that person who's never been born again, who's never accepted Jesus as their Lord and Savior. I pray for that person who is blinded, God, the one who's joined a church role, the one who's depending on grandma or grandpa or mom or dad or money or some other things to get them to heaven. I pray, God, for those individuals, first of all, God, that they realize that the blood of Jesus is the only way. Calvary is the only way. And Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life, and he'll calm the storm. I pray, God, for that Christian this morning who is carnal, who's backed away, who's chosen to run, who's chosen to do it the other way, who's living in sin, who's not giving and honoring the Lord with their life, and they're dying on the vine. I pray for that individual, God, that they receive life, forgiveness from you this morning upon their own doing, God. You tell us that we'll talk about me. You don't force it on us. It's up to us. God, I pray for that individual, God, who's living the life on a mountaintop. God, that we, whoever they are, God, don't forget that, God, you're God and you're in control and you're the reason that we are where we are. So God, I pray this morning for the sovereignty of God. I pray, Father, for our moments like this morning. God, I pray that we open ourselves up to you and let the Holy Spirit of God work like it's never been. God, I pray, knowing that you want to meet needs this morning, that we would like to do it. God, you minister. God, you know the hearts of individuals. You know what needs to take place. And so, God, we want to bless you for this time in Jesus' name this morning. May he get all the glory. Pray this prayer in his name. Amen. And amen.
Because still know that you're going to move. I will allow you passively to take a hold of my heart. And actively, God, I will take a hold of you. Because you're my only hope. My only hope, my only hope. Forgetting what is behind. That's no longer the deciding factor in my life. So God, we just look to you this morning. Either we've been through a storm and we can remember, God, what you've done for us, or we're going through one. God, we need you in that equally. So God, we just look to you this morning. That in the eye of the storm, God, you remain in control. In the middle of the war, God, you can calm our soul. You alone are my anchor when my sails are torn. Hello, the storm. In the middle of the storm. God, we just look to you this morning. In Jesus' name.
Hebrews 13 this morning. The fact that God does care. God wants to move in our life. God cares about us. We've heard it said many times, more than we care about our own self. Said something a moment ago in the prayer. It's been on my mind, a devotional that I read. God's grace is greater than my shame. To think about that today. And God's grace is greater than my shame. A lot of people live in shame. A lot of people get caught up in yesterday and last year and months ago and all of those kinds of things. You're in Bible study this morning, Philippians. Paul says, forgetting what's behind, straining, moving forward to what's ahead. We've got to get past the past. If you're in the building this morning and you're caught up in the past, you will never be what God wants you to be. If you're miserable, if you're mad, if you're angry, if you're holding grudges, if you're pointing fingers at others or yourself, you'll never become what God wants you to become. And so Paul says you got to put the past behind you. Let it go. Give it to the Lord. Some people say, well, it's easier done than said. Or easier said than done. And it is. But the thing is when you do that, when you can constantly put it in the Lord's hands, He'll move you forward. And so this morning, I want you to understand, God cares. You know, we're finishing up Hebrews, and we've been looking at that for a long time, just off and on, and taking a peek at what God's been doing in the midst of that, and the fact that He's wrapping it all together, that Jesus is worthy. Jesus is better. And we're bringing it down to the end where that battle's going on, and it's in the midst of Judaism. Those folks are trying to run back. And all the time, the writer of Hebrews said, look, forget what's behind you. Look forward to what's ahead and know that God cares. And that's the word He has for you and me today, is the fact that He cares. We live in a world, and we probably have gotten to the point at times where we say, God, where are you? What is the deal, God? I don't understand all this. And God, are you even on the same planet with me? But the fact is that God cares. Last week we looked at that in Psalms 51 of, God, you return to me the joy of your salvation. God, I want that joy. And when we realize that He cares, then that joy just kind of exudes from that. And so we looked at those words last week of restoration and sustaining and all of that, where we talked about from the standpoint of God's work in our life, and the result of that would be to go and share the gospel, to teach others, to invite others. I asked you to invite folks this week. I saw some of you put it on Facebook, and that's all well and good as well. I'm glad you did. And so let's be about that. Be about inviting. I told you to write down some names. Some that were not saved, but also the Holy Spirit gave you those names. So you take the words of God. Write them down. Those people that are unchurched, that are not living a life that would be pleasing to the Lord, that you can do that, and you can write it down, and you'll invite that person. You'll go to that person. I ask you this today, the same thing, to write, take that back of the words of God. Maybe it's the same name over this week that was last week, and God wants you to pray for them. Write them down. As Holy Spirit gives them to you right now. Write them down. And throughout the day and tomorrow, maybe give you another name. Write them down. Ask them to meet you here for worship. Ask them to meet you for Bible study. Take them to get a Coke or coffee or hamburger or something. Spend some time with them and see what God does. God cares about them. God cares about you. God cares about us. And one of the major things I told you last week that we're learning about the Southern Baptist denomination, any other denomination, except for some of those that are, we would consider, cultish. They're inviting others, and they're out seeking. And you and I need to be doing the same. And that's where we are slacking as Christians. And so, today, God does care. Look at Hebrews 13. Let's look at verse 19. I want to back up one verse. And then 19, 20, and 21. The writer of Hebrews says, "And I urge you all the more to do this, that I may be restored to you the sooner." You may be wondering why I did that, because the pastor was away there and writing this evidently. But then he says, "Now the God of peace, who brought up from the dead the great shepherd of the sheep through the blood of the eternal covenant, even Jesus our Lord. May the God of peace equip you in every good thing to do His will, working in us that which is pleasing." There's a goal right there. "That which is pleasing, not in my sight, not in your sight, but in His sight, in God's sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory forever and ever." And I remind you what the banner says behind me, that the fields were white in the harvest, and God gives the victory through Jesus Christ. This is a storm. God cares. Go to the Lord with me. Father, right now, I pray that our hearts are open. Holy Spirit, I'm asking you to move upon us, to guide, to guard our lives, to guide us today, to Lord, show us, make it demonstrate, God, your care to us this morning. Right here in this moment, at this time, God, demonstrate that love, and God, just that you care about us more than we care about ourselves. Thank you, Lord Jesus, and we bless you in Jesus' name. Amen. When you think about the fact of just asking the question, God, are you really here? I mean, there's probably not a one of us in here, if you've been born again very long, you've asked that question. God, are you, maybe even before you were born again, you said, God, are you for real? In Stand Firm this week, you got to read Stand Firm, and there's some out there, and some of the journeys as well. Let me quote the author on what he said. He wrote an article on holiness, and he said, "Holiness and the idea of holiness leads to worship." And then he quoted William Temple, and he says this, "To worship is to quicken the conscience by the holiness of God." To worship is to quicken the conscience by the holiness of God. Quicken the conscience. Think about that. To make aware, to literally desire the holiness, the righteousness of God. In order to do that, we need to realize that God cares. To understand that God loves us. He went on to say, I wrote down, what would it be like to be captivated by God's holiness? To know that God cares. Like last week, to know that you know that you know that you're born again. To know that you know that you know that you're going to spend eternity in heaven. And he went on to say, he said, the holiness of God will produce a shaking in our boots. Listen. And not just a fuzzy feeling. Well, I'm telling you, I think that's the attitude of many Christians today. We want the fuzzy feeling. We want to feel good, but we don't want what goes along with it. And Paul's talking about this morning, forgetting what's behind in Philippians, but striving forward. And that striving forward is difficult at times. Difficult at best. But God has called us to do that and spoken into our life from that standpoint, knowing that He cares, and taking our hearts and our conscience and just consuming it with holiness. And the fact of God's love and His mercy and the presence of God that's seared on my heart, your heart, our minds together, to know that He wants each of us literally to submit to Him, to walk where He wants us to walk, to be who He wants us to be. And at that point, we learn from Scripture that God is often willing to work. But, that word but, that three-letter word, often He waits for us to get earnest, our own self, to be earnest about the matter ourselves. God's ready to work. God's ready to do some stuff. stuff. I believe he's ready to do it in this church, whether it's the body here, the body wherever. But he's waiting for you and me and others like us to be earnest about seeking the will of God, about allowing him to do the work that he really wants to do, to be serious. I mean, that we get serious about the strongholds. And I just recently purchased, and some of the other guys purchased Johnny Hunt's book, Patrick, I know several of them did, on strongholds, demolishing strongholds. It's Pastor Johnny's newest book, and talking about what holds us back and the sin that so entangles us, and strongholds that we have to demolish, and realizing that God does care. And when we get serious about that, then God will help us to deal with all of that and to get rid of those strongholds in our life so God can do his greatest work in my life, in your life, and ultimately his church. And it can be an addiction, it can be habits, it can be whatever it is. But we acknowledge it and then move from it. The last part of that, and the leader's guide this morning, it says to acknowledge the sin and then move away from it. See, what so many times we do is we know the sin's there, but we like it. And so we keep participating in it. And so therefore it separates us from God. God's in a deal with porn. Some of you guys in here, you're looking at porn on a daily basis. You're never going to be what God wants you to be as long as you're pushing the button. You got to call it what it is. Some of the other addictions that are present in here this morning, you're not going to get past that and get where God wants you to be until you submit yourselves under the authority of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so when you think about that, that last thing says to acknowledge the sin, put it in the past, put Jesus in the forefront, and move forward to really look at what God wants to do in our own life. And you know, we used to kind of think, well, I'm immune to that. No, we're not. Just because we come and sit in a building like this and we call ourselves going to church or worship, we're not immune to it. We're seeing our young people deal with some major issues in their life. We're seeing parents deal with things that they've never dealt with before. And I'm telling you, you and I need to bring it to the forefront and understand what's happening. Verse 19, that writer's asking for prayer, that the circumstances will literally change. And the fact that things will take place in what God wants to happen. Realizing this morning that God is sovereign. I find that I mentioned in our class, you know, we were talking, I mentioned last Sunday about the sovereignty of God, Pastor Johnny and him with his little granddaughter. And the sovereignty of God has been on my mind nearly all week, just different things. Early this morning here and just praying and thinking. And think about the sovereignty of God. And I hope God's going to open it up where I can do a message on the sovereignty of God, because I wonder if we say we believe that God is sovereign, but the issue with that is we mess with the sovereignty of God. How do we mess with it in our own life? We don't let God have his way in our own personal life. We put him, and then we'll say, yeah, I believe in the sovereignty of God, but then we do everything to define where we're going. We do everything to tell where we're going to walk. We do everything to say where we're going to spend our money. We do everything to say how we're going to treat the people around us. Instead of putting it in the hands of the sovereign God and submitting ourselves to his leadership. And really seeking the will of God. To really become more and more like Jesus, what we were studying this morning. Moving forward and doing what God has called us to do. I'm telling you, God wants us to get serious and really just submit ourselves. And know that he cares. So out of the scripture this morning, when we think about God does care, what do we need to gain from that? Jim and I didn't talk about the service this morning, but I want you to see what God does in the midst of all of that. The first thing I want you to understand this morning in the midst that God cares about you is that God's a God of peace. God's a God of peace. When you think about, when the writer of Hebrews was trying his best to get that across to his readers and to us, now the God of peace, I mean right there it jumps up at you, the God of peace. I want you to think about that. I mean only God knows what you and I walked in this building with this morning. Only God knows what maybe you've been on your knees before God this week dealing with in the midst of turmoil and all of that kind of stuff that's going on. But I'm telling you, God desires more than any other time in our life to demonstrate peace. Tranquility that comes through a relationship with him. And the Word of God tells us that God's peace is really beyond our understanding. But God says that it'll transcend that, but he'll grant it to our minds. He'll grant it to our hearts in Philippians chapter 4. And so the writer's reminding the readers there that the war is won when we settle the issue with Jesus Christ. He's telling the Hebrew people, say, look, you folks come out of Judaism. The war has been won. Jesus Christ is the answer. But the battles are going to be there. And we may lose a few battles. But at the end, the war is going to be won. And so you and I this morning can take hold of that when we think about the peace of Almighty God. I mean, why is it different? Because Jesus begins to fight for us. Because He's the one. The Holy Spirit is out front. He's the warrior. I think I saw on the back of the worship guide. You know, April was going to put it there, but you may not have saw it. But look what it says. On the back of the worship guide, it says, the devil whispers, you can't withstand the storm. And the warrior replied, I am the storm. Telling you, God is the answer in the midst of the storm. He is the one who grants the peace there. That God, through the Lord Jesus Christ, fights those battles. Think about it, unholy man versus a holy God. And Jesus Christ is the one in the battles. He's the one that settles the issues. He's the one that's there for us. He's the peace giver. He's the way maker, the song says. He's the chain breaker. I'll be hearing that for the next few weeks. I hope you're listening to the radio. Go and Google that. Take a look at it. And then just be ready. Because He is a way maker. And He is a chain breaker. And He's the God who cares about us. It's the peace of God that transcends, that surpasses all our understanding. But He guards our hearts. In the middle of the war. Did you catch that this morning? In the middle of the war, He guards our soul. Even before that, the song says, in the eye of the storm, when the sails are torn, God is the peace that transcends. We may not understand it, but when it comes, we'll see the hand of God. If we'll be looking for it and we open ourselves, I'm telling you, the Lord Jesus settled the predicament that you and I would have been in. And some of us this morning, I want you to hear that. The midst of the predicament that you're in this morning, whatever it is, I want you to know that God cares about you. I want you to know that God wants to settle you this morning. Doesn't mean the issue. Doesn't mean the challenge. Doesn't mean the mountain that you feel like is before you is going to go away. But God, in the midst of the peace that He'll give you, will see you through to the other side. That's what He wants us to see. And in the midst of, maybe some of us are thinking, you know, I want to go back. You know, we've had guys in our transition ministry. They told me this week that two guys left out of, check this out. And you guys, two guys at Mercy House this week drank hand sanitizer. And of course got drunk on it. But the danger of that, I can't even begin to fathom. Sometimes, why we do what we do. But it's so easy to run back. I've not been in that position. But what we're trying to, somebody's in my mind right now this morning of a battle that's going on, and he's out there all alone right now at his choice. And he's failing. Good for a few days and then failing. And good for a few days and then failing. And what we're trying to get our men to see is, God, we need each other. Don't go to the bottle hand sanitizer. Don't go to the whatever you choose. Don't push the button on the computer. Call somebody. Call another guy. Call another lady if you're a lady. Say, man, I'm struggling. I am struggling. I'm having a hard time. I don't know what it's going to take for us as society to understand. Some of you young people this morning, you're hiding behind things in your life and you know it's not right and you need to come forth and you need to tell somebody. Can't go to your parents. Find somebody you can go to. It's amazing. We need to understand this morning that God cares, and in the midst of the storm, He wants to give us peace. And I just want to believe somebody that's feeling this morning, something's eating you up, eating you alive. Eating you alive, and you're struggling with it. I want to plead with you this morning. As best I understand, according to the Word of God, that you give it to the Lord, and you bring people around you, and let God give you the peace to overcome and discipline in your lives. You know, the Word of God tells us what we need to do if we'll just do it. If we'll just do it. The sovereignty of God. Are you able to trust in the peace of God? God cares. And God wants us to have peace. He's a God of peace. You know somebody in turmoil? Some of us are here this morning. We're in turmoil. We're in the midst of the storm. We're in the midst of the war. Bombshells flooding in our life and blowing up around us. God cares. I tell you, you got people around you that care. Don't let the enemy speak into your life that you're all alone. You're not all alone. I guarantee you there's people in here. We started sharing testimonies. Somebody over here say something. Somebody said, well, I've been through that, or I'm going through that right now. We need each other. I'm telling you guys, some of you guys are loners. We get you for an hour a week, and that's it. Some of you ladies may not even get you for that long. And you have a hard time. I'm asking some pastors this morning to get serious. Ask you to make some efforts to be together. Get up a little early, get your Bible study. Set some time spots aside so you can be at different groups. Encourage your young people to be a part. Encourage your children. Bring the little ones. Start them in the little. Let them know that God cares. He's a God of peace. Secondly, this morning, according to Scripture, how do you know God cares? Not only just because of the peace, but He's a God of peace, but He's a God of provision. I want you to just think about your life. Some of you have been Christians for a short period of time. But others have been Christians for a long period of time. You've been born again. And it's sad that you can't hardly even say Christian anymore just because people take it to a different avenue. You've been born again. And you've seen the provision of Christ. I want you to see it from Scripture, what the Hebrew writer is trying to say. Not only the God of peace, but look what he says, who brought up from the dead the great shepherd, that is Jesus Christ, of the sheep through the blood covenant. And so he's a provider. Then he goes down and he talks about equipment. He talks about working. All that kind of stuff that he's working in us. I want to tell you that God wants to provide for me and you. God wants to touch our life, and even in the midst of the storm, God, in the midst of His fingertips, puts a hand of protection around us. Folks who give testimonies this week to the hand of God on their life, and in a split second, life could have changed for them. But why didn't it? Because God moved. God was in the midst of the storm, and I'm telling you, when you look at the Word of God, what the Hebrew writer is trying to say, that God brought forth, listen, His only Son. And he watched him die on a cross, the blood covenant. He watched him go to the tomb. He rose him up in the tomb, the resurrection. So he defeated death there. He's a provider in the fact that he loves us. And he cared enough for me. He cared enough for you. That he sent his only Son. So, and I have two of our children here this morning. Chris is not here. But I'm telling you, I wouldn't give neither one of them for you. He gave it all. He gave it all for us. And the thing is, when we look at it, the fact that He does care about us, that He allowed His only Son to die, that He provided life through the death and resurrection of His Son, He defeated death. Oh, death, where is that victory? It's the presence of God. Jesus went to the dark dungeon of death for me. Saw this morning, according to Scripture, where Paul was crying. The only time we find where Paul was crying, in the midst of all the beatings and all that, the only time we find Paul reported in Philippians that he was crying. And it was because of the enemies of Christ. I tell you, we need to think about that. We need to think about the fact of that God cared so much that He provided His Son. And I'm telling you, it ought to break our hearts. We see folks who reject Jesus, who laugh in his face and all that kind of stuff, break our hearts. Colossians chapter 1, Paul writes that we have peace through the blood of the cross. We have tranquility. We have victory through the blood of the cross. God's peace is provided through the cross. We don't have to work for it. Jesus did all the work. And he didn't break down that. When you think about it, he's talking about the shepherd there. Break down from the standpoint of the cross and the shepherd. We have the good shepherd, John 10, 11, where the good shepherd gives his life for his sheep. That for the church, for me and you, that's Calvary. That's what I'm talking about. The good shepherd. But then we have the great shepherd when we think about that. And from the standpoint that he defeated death and the grave. And for the church, that's resurrection. That's life. We're about to celebrate Easter in just a few months. And the fact that he defeated Satan at that point. So we have the good shepherd. We have the great shepherd. We have the chief shepherd. And you think about the chief shepherd. That's the one that's going to be coming for his sheep. The fact is the second coming. All that consumed in the Lord Jesus Christ, the same yesterday and forever in verse 8. For God is a God of provision. He loves to meet the need of me and you. He loves that. He loves to meet our need, not our wants. Even though he'll meet our wants. But he tells us he's going to meet our needs. There's times he'll meet our wants just because he wants to bless us. But he can't meet our wants if we're not willing to bless him with what he gives us. He gives us what he gives us to bless others, so then he can bless us even more. That's the God we serve. It's the way he does things. That's not your pastor saying that. That's what the Word of God says. God, through Jesus Christ, provided redemption. Think about that. The fact that he saved us. He provided restoration, that he justified us, just as if I had never sinned. And then he's got rewards on the horizon. He sets us free. I am come that they might have life, abundant life, now and forevermore. Right now, he sets us free. God cares. God cares. Wow. He's a God of peace. He's a God of provision. And finally this morning, God's got the promise. How do we know he cares? Because he has never broken one promise. I dare say there's probably not an individual in here that hasn't broken a promise. No, I broke a promise. God's never broken a promise. I'm telling you, he cares for us. He's not a promise breaker. He's not a promise stealer. He's not somebody sitting up there in heaven and created us and sitting up there with his fingers crossed. When he makes a promise and he uncrosses, so I got the fingers crossed. He's not that kind. He makes the promise. And he sticks with it. And he wants to give us the victory in our own life. And the Word of God this morning is talking about when he says the great shepherd of the sheep through the blood of the eternal covenant. The eternal promise of God. Jesus our Lord. The purpose there to equip us in every good thing for what? To do his will. To do what else? To work in us so that we can be pleasing in his life. The victory that God gives in Jesus Christ. It's the promise that he gives. That old covenant of work and one sacrifice after another, after another, after another. And the shame that comes with that is replaced by Jesus Christ. His grace will overcome, overpower my shame. It'll overcome your shame and overpower your shame. And with that, he removes the guilt. And when you think about guilt is from the enemy. That's what Satan uses to hold us back. Patrick and Wednesday night talked about doubt. When Woodstock, we heard Pastor talk about doubt. We heard him talk about fear. All of that holds us back. It causes us to withdraw. God wants us to power forward. God wants us to rev up the engines and move forward under the promises of God that he'll never forsake us or leave us. He'll be there with us. God is there. God cares that he doesn't want to hold us back. He gives us freedom to go forward. Why? Because he does care. That's why he did what he did with Jesus, with the cross and the blood, the tomb, and the resurrection. And we know that God in the middle of the storm. God's there. God cares. When sails are torn, when things seem like it's all over, God gives the promises to equip us. Remember the old saying, it's so true, God doesn't call the equipped. He equips the call. And I've seen that on one of our guys' Facebook, I mean, you're equipped. But the fact that God equips those he calls, that means every one of us. Born again this morning, he equips us. He touches us, he empowers us, he strengthens us. Everybody in this building, I'm sure, has been guilty to say at some point or another, I can't. You see, we need to get to that point. But we need to get to that point in the right mindset. Because when we say I can't, that means God can. If we submit ourselves unto the authority of the Lord Jesus Christ, God will do what he needs to do. He's a promise keeper. He will not break his promises. And God wants to do what he will do in our life. How does he do it, Pastor? How do we do it? As we draw to the end this morning, I want you to understand, God cares. How do we know this? How does God equip us? He equips us by the Word of God. You've got to read your Word of God. Either that or you've got to listen to it. Can't read it, listen to it audibly. Just get it and let it play. Because God equips and God gives direction through the Word of God. Through the prayer. Just spending time with God. You might not even have to say a word. Somebody might say, well, Pastor, I don't even know how to pray. Try this week. Just go in the presence of God. And if you're born again, say, Lord, here am I. Here I am, God. I'm sitting here, God, and I just want you to speak to me. Will you just take time out and listen? Watch what God does. Don't say a word. Just listen. Think about those folks that he wants the Holy Spirit's giving you those names to invite. Maybe somebody to share Jesus with, or go spend them, get a cup of coffee or a Coke with, whatever. But just think about it, the promises of God. Think about what God's promised you. Think about what he's promised me. The amazing gifts of God. I've come that they might have life and have life abundantly. So the Word of God, through prayer, through people. God equips us through people. That's why you need to be together. If you don't come to this guy's group or this lady's group, find you a group of guys to get with. Start one of your own. I've got an outline for you. You can take it. It's ready made. Ready to go. Pick one or two or three or four guys and get after it. Whatever. Just see what God will do. God uses people like us to touch others. How else? The way some of us walked in this building this morning, through pain and suffering. Through pain and suffering, different things in our life that are going on. God's trying to equip us for the next step. We may not like where we are. We may not agree where we are. Do we believe in the sovereignty of God? Have we done something to get us there? Look at all of that. Then back up and say, okay. Help me see. Help me be clear. And then through the Holy Spirit, God works. God does care, and he does the work, and he wants the glory. Verse 21 says that he's doing his work. He wants to equip us in every good thing to do his will, working in us for the ultimate reason that our lives would be pleasing in his sight. You know, I would hope that there would be a one of us in here this morning with the realization that one day we're going to cross over from this life to the next. And it's my prayer this morning that every one of us is going to hear, well done. Well done. Not good. Faithful servant. That's why God cares. Doesn't matter how you start. It doesn't matter that you entered this building after viewing porn or whatever you did yesterday or last night, whatever your activity level was, how much you prayed yesterday or day before, or how much you read your Bible, doesn't matter at all. But it matters how you finish. People remember how you finish. They don't necessarily even know how you start, but people remember. What God says is that he wants us to finish well. Well done. Not good and faithful, sir. So this morning I remind you.